You can go ahead and start.
Okay, ready for me? All right, this is Charlie Dukes. My name is Brent Cochran, and technician is Henry Ratcliffe. The date is February 7th, 2008. It's WILL-AM-FM-TV, Studio X at Campbell Hall in Urbana, Illinois. Mr. Dukes, can you tell me about when you joined the military? How did you join?
I got out of high school at Georgetown, Illinois in 1941, and worked at Chanute Air Force during the summer on construction, and then I went to Indiana University in the fall, and was lucky enough to join a fraternity right off the bat, so I had my room and board, and I spent my freshman year at IU. I was 18 years old, and spent that whole year. Then I came back home and worked during the summer, went back in the fall, and that was 1942. And I don't know, about October, in fact, it was 26th of October, about six of us fraternity guys are sitting around one day, and we felt kind of guilty because we were losing every battle in the war, except I think maybe one naval battle, but the land wars, we were losing, so we felt guilty. So the six of us go downtown Bloomington, Indiana, for Indiana University. We're all going to join the Marines. Well, I still only weighed about 123 or 124 pounds, and I was 5'11", 6 foot tall. And the recruiter sort of hum-hawed around and said, well, we're filled up right now. You come back in 6 months. So we were sort of, all of us were tall, skinny, I guess. So we all went downtown, a couple blocks downtown Bloomington, walked in the recruiting office, Army, sat down, and the recruiter just gave us a piece of paper and says, sign here. It's that simple. So we ended up in the regular Army. Not the U.S. Army, not the Army of the United States. Now, if you're drafted, that was the Army of the United States. And I got a serial number, 5th Service Command, 15304-102. Got my dog tags, and I was in the Army. But I let us stay in reserves in school while to finish the semester. But we had ROTC, and the Army was in charge of the ROTC, so we had quite a bit of training. Maneuvers. In fact, I spent Christmas vacation with the ROTC, so I didn't get home for that first Christmas in 1942. I was called to active service in 43 and shipped to Texas, and Camp Phantom was a brand new infantry camp in Tyler, and in fact, I had to work about a week getting things ready to go. But it was a 17 weeks basic, and normally it's only 13 weeks, a normal basic in World War II, and it was rough. But I found out most of us were college boys, and so we were training for OCS. I didn't realize that. So training ended about, I don't know, in July, and you had the choice of going to Officers Candidate School, or what they call ASTP, Army Specialized Training, which was engineers. I didn't want to be an infantry officer, so I chose engineers, and I was transferred from the infantry to engineers and shipped to New York City and Fordham University, 198th Street and Fordham Road. And we took a full semester of engineering courses in 3 months. Well, I passed the first 3 months, and I got the second course, and I didn't get home for that Christmas either. Classes right through. Well, in February and March, where they were getting ready for the D-Day landings, and they were short of infantry soldiers, so all the schools were closed all at once. And typically Army, I went from Texas to New York. From New York, I was shipped to Fort Carson, Colorado. And I joined the Timberwolf Division. And I come to find out the commander was Terry Allen, who had the 1st Division North Africa assisting Italy, came back and sold the Army on the idea of having a night fighting division, period. So when we all arrived at the camp, and we were all standing out there in the open, and the general gets up on the stage and walks over and looks us over and says, "Oh, what have we got here? A bunch of college sillies. We're going to show you what the Army is really like." Turn around left. He said, you're going to be refined to camp for 30 days, and we'll be training 7 days a week. So I went into barracks with my outfit, L Company. I was in the 2nd Squad, 2nd Platoon, 413th Infantry, and we trained. I mean, they were rough on us. And the thing was, we were 5,300 feet up in the air at rarefied air, so for the first 3 or 4 days, they really worked us. But I was with the company, and at the end of the 30 days, everybody came together, and we became a full company, 187 men, you know, on maneuvers. And their basic wasn't any worse than what I'd already been through, so I was able to take it. Well, by this time, I was up to about 180 pounds and in good, tough shape, thank God. So after D-Day, we were put on alert, got our POM requirements, late July and August, we loaded our equipment on flat cars and headed east to Camp Kilmer, New Jersey. I was there about 6 or 7 days, got all my shots and all that sort of stuff. And one night, we sent out motor launches and boarded a ship out of New York Harbor. And my whole regiment was on that one ship. And we were at sea for 13 days in one big convoy. And we got into Europe and up the English Channel and at Cherbourg. But we couldn't go in and land on the beach because the harbor was full of sunken ships and it was a mess. So we anchored out in the channel and went over the side in cargo nets, full field equipment into LCIs, landing craft infantry. As soon as we hit shore, we went on a 49-mile forced march across the peninsula and bivouacked in a little town called Barneyville. And trained down on the pillboxes down on the beach, was right below us. We were there about, probably less than a week. And we packed up on a Sunday night. In fact, it's kind of odd. They said, take your shoulder patches off, take them in your pocket. I don't know why. We took a 35-mile force march with full field equipment. And you get a 10-minute break every hour. And it was up and down the darn kind of the hills and valleys of the peninsula, so it was really rough going. We got there at daylight on the next day and boarded cattle cars, French cattle cars, and headed north. Well, we ended up outside of Brussels, Belgium, in a village called Malines. Pitched our tents, got them nosed around, and that first night, through about five of us slipped out of camp and went into the edge of Brussels to a movie. And we walked in and everything was blacked out. And we had our rifles with us and everything else. And we were sitting in the front row of the balcony. And the movie came on and it was in English, but it was dubbed in foreign language underneath. So it was a comedy. It was called It's a Date with Deanna Durbin. Well, every joke, the five of us guys sitting up there laughing, and the rest of the people wouldn't laugh till it come across the bottom of the thing. So it was sort of odd, everybody looking at us, and we were the only outsiders in the whole darn theater. But that was one of the first night before I went into battle. And being trained as night fighters, of course, we jumped off in the daytime. Not too much problem the first day, but the second day we made a night attack into a village and run into what we call an MLR, a main line of resistance. And I mean, it was full of machine guns and mortars and anything else. And I had been designated as a lead scout. And another kid was second scout named Keeler. And we were walking down this blacktop road, pitch black. And we'd take turns. We'd go about maybe 10 or 12 yards, and then we'd kind of talk wheel light. He'd stop, and then we'd just leapfrog on each side of the road. No idea what was going on. And all of a sudden, a machine gun opens up. Well, as luck would have it, I lucked out, and Keeler got hit immediately. He hit the ground, and he was killed immediately. I crawled over to him, and the machine gun was sputtering around, so I went to the right-hand side in the ditch, and the ditch was just enough to cover my body. And we carried, at that time, a light pack all the time with a shelter half and a blanket. And everything I owned was on my back. And finally, a machine gun on my right flank was firing oblique fire across the road. And every so often, they would put a few bullets into my pack. Well, I finally had to take it off and lay it on the road. And I laid there and dug into the ground. And about this time, my company made an attack on up the road and on both sides. Well, they hit all this murderous fire, and they were just completely mowed down. My sergeant was killed. He was a Mohawk Indian. He was killed immediately. And they never did get to me. And so I was pinned down way ahead of them. They finally just backed off. We had 26 casualties in my company that first night. So I laid there all night. I couldn't crawl back. Every time I moved, the machine gun would open up. So I just laid there during the night, and I made a said a simple prayer. I said, if the good Lord will allow me to see the sunrise, I'll say good morning for the rest of my life. And that's what I've done. And that's where when I finally wrote a book 10 years ago, that's where the title comes from. And I say good morning 24 hours a day. It gets me in a little bit of trouble. And I never explain it to anybody. I'd say, well, that's just a habit I've got. Come daylight, to back up a second or two, when we got in the States, our division commander, who had the 1st Division in North Africa, Sicily, and Italy, couldn't wait for us to join the American Army. Well, we found out they dropped the boys at Nijmegen and Arnhem, the 101st Airborne and the 1st British Unicorn Division, and they were being systematically annihilated. And so we were attached to the 1st Canadian Army, and our job was to rescue the guys out of Nijmegen and Arnhem. I had the 4th Canadian Division on the left flank, British 49th Polar Bear Division on our right flank, and we were in the center. And man, we fought night and day. There's many a night I never even had to lay down to sleep. I think I slept walking, but it was continuous. And taking tremendous casualties. Well, several little things popped up. Like, for instance, my second day in battle, we were in a firefight, and a white flag goes up, and everybody ceases firing. A German stands up and starts hollering, "Kamerad." Well, a couple of our boys jump up with their rifles and take him as prisoner. Well, soon they expose themselves. He drops in the foxhole, and they open up, and two of our boys are killed immediately. So that's one of the first lessons you learn. You kill the enemy that's in front of you. So we go through this all the way up, I think it was about the 6th of November, we finally reached the Moss River, and that's as far as we could go. And I guess some of the boys got out, they did rescue a few of them, but most of them were either killed, wounded, or captured, those two divisions. And the last day I was there, a little incident happened that I never will forget. We were out near the Moss at the edge of a village, and it was pretty well destroyed, except one house at the end of the village was still standing, and there were some people living in it. But I had dug my foxhole at the edge of their yard, the north edge of their yard. And I was filthy, dirty, muddy. I hadn't had a change of clothes. And Holland is awful wet anyway. Water table's about a foot below the surface. And I just finished my foxhole, and I was in it, and I heard a kind of a whimpering noise. So I climbed up, and it was just about dark, and here come a little girl, must be about 13, 14 years old, dressed, walking across the yard toward me, and she was crying. And she walked up to me, threw her arms around me, and she come about to hero me, And pretty soon she looked up at me and she said, Yank, I want to thank you. Tonight will be the first night I can go to bed and be free for the past 4 years. The Nazis had been in Holland or the Netherlands for the last 4 years. Well, what could I do? I broke down, tears streamed down my face, and I hugged her. And she kept crying. Pretty soon she let go and turned around and walked back to the house. And I just jumped back in my foxhole. But that gave me the strength that really I was doing something good. We moved out early the next morning, went in Liège, Belgium, supposedly for a 7-day rest and replacements. There for 2 hours, a row of trucks come in, mount up. So we went into Aachen and replaced the 1st Division. And we cleaned up Aachen and went out edge of Aachen into the Siegfried Line. Took us 3 days to break through the Siegfried Line. And by this time, a lot of the guys had trench foot. And we were on all kinds of problems. But they maybe let one or two guys go back at a time. But we were just short-handed. Out of my combat division, company, 187 men, we had 263 replacements during our 200 days in combat. My point is, it's the infantry that takes the beating. Just for instance, out of your total, out of 16.5 million boys and girls who were in World War II, 18% of that total was infantry. But we suffered 78% of all casualties in during World War II. So we were taking the brunt of it. Well, by this time I was all beat up. I had trench foot. I couldn't even take my shoes off because my feet would swell up and I couldn't get my shoes back on. We'd get a clean pair of socks a day. Well, what good would that do? We kept kept going into the center of Germany. And I finally fought my last battle on Thanksgiving Day. It was Hill 303, and as usual, a very strategic battle. We jumped off at 4:30 in the morning, took the forward slope, and we're going down the reverse slope of the hill. And we had what we called a roving fire, in which we would have our artillery would bring in and put a line of fire in front of us. And sooner that the shells exploded, we would jump up and try to catch the enemy in their foxhole before they could get out of their foxhole. That was a theory. Well, I guess it worked pretty well, but we had that rolling barrage down the hill. And we get down to the bottom, and our forward observer got hit, and our SCR 300 radio knocked out. So he didn't call the last remnant where we were, the grid coordinates where the last fire was supposed to come in. And we were in a moon time, had the Germans on a run, and we're running and pushing them down the hill. They were retreating, and we had bayonets, all we had. Get down there, and this last barrage comes in behind us. Excuse me. And I get hit with my own artillery. But I was running so fast, I had everything I owned on, including my overcoat and all of my winter clothing. So the shrapnel got below my overcoat in the bottom part of my legs and in the calves of both legs, and I got hit in both hands. I got knocked down, but I was scared, so I picked myself back up and I kept attacking. We got down, our objective was a big factory. We get down the edge of the factory, and then we get pinned down by machine gun fire and small arms fire. So we try to get back up as well, get into German foxholes. Well, we're trying to decide what to do to recoup. And then about that time, there's five Tiger tanks come barreling around the edges of that big factory. And they were firing machine guns and cannon, 88s point blank right at us. Just, and I don't remember anything. I mean, I got so shell shocked and I lost my head, I guess. And then at that time, behind the tanks came the German infantry. So when they came up, we retreated as best we could back to, there was a big trench that goes right across that whole field. It was a communications trench. And the thing that got me up to my left, one of my buddies got into a foxhole. Well, this big old tank comes up and puts his tread over that foxhole and just grinds him right in the ground, you know, and we could hear him screaming. So my buddy Lou and I decided we better get back to that trench. So we got back to that. Well, then the infantry came up. We jumped up. I was out of ammo by then, no hand grenades, nothing but my bayonet. And we were systematically beaten and taken. I was drugged down the hill. I ended up in that basement of that factory. There, a short time, they come in. We're moved out. And I found out later we had 78 casualties that day. There was 41 men left in my company. And that's out of original 187 men. So you can see how many casualties we had had. We weren't getting replacements to keep up with today's battles. That's how short we were. We were immediately moved out, and I was forced to walk for the next 10 days behind the German lines and in a column of threes, and it kept getting bigger. Well, they were kept picking up a few prisoners along the way out of the Battle of the Bulge, which I didn't know anything about because this is November. And we were strafed by American planes on a couple occasions, so we finally went in a column of four, and then we'd stagger down the road so the Air Force guys know that it was not German soldiers. Those 10 days, I slept in a barn two nights. The rest of the time, we just slept out around these houses in a field that usually were surrounded with fencing, and I slept in the snow, but I had my complete uniform. Finally, we crossed the Rhine River, and then I was picked up and taken down to Limburg, which was Stalag 12A, and I finally got some help on my wounded legs. Well, some of the boys were wounded worse than I was, and there wasn't that much medical attention, and it was some American medics in there. So they laid me on the floor and sat on me and held my legs down while he picked out what shrapnel they could. I still had shrapnel in my legs. He picked out what he could, but I got such a wonderful body that everything healed over pretty well. I didn't have any infections. I don't know why, because I was muddy as the devil. I was in that hospital. As near as I can tell, I got there 10 days after the 23rd, and I was there till the 19th. And on the 19th, they called us out one in the morning and into a room, said, "We're going to give you a hot shower. Take off your uniform." So we took our uniforms off and in a neat little pile so we remember. But I kept my shoes on and my underclothes. Went into this room, had some spigots up there, but it was a little bit of cold water. Some of them didn't get wet. And then we were moved out into another room, and there was a big pile of clothing. They said, "Get dressed." So the clothing I had to wear, I had a pair of trousers that came about 6 inches above my ankles, a real thin blue overcoat that had a split up the side, a stocking cap and a scarf, and that was and a shirt, and that was it. And they gave me a rope for a belt, and my pants came over, a little too big for me. It was stuff out of these concentration camps. Well, what I didn't realize, they wanted those uniforms. And I found out years later that my uniform was used in infiltration in the Aachen area by the Germans into my division. So I've always felt kind of bad, but nothing I could do about it. So we got out of there, we're loaded in boxcars. Well, we were in that boxcar going across southern Germany, and night and day, no food, no water, was never allowed out. And we were strafed several times by American planes. But usually they come in from the side, and we could get on the floor, and most of the bullets went over our heads. Nobody, as far as I know, well, a couple guys, I think, got hit. Finally, one night, about 2,200 hours, we pulled into an area, and the doors were open. There was snow on the ground. And I remember jumping out of the boxcar into the siding, and it just went head over heels. And I realized then my feet were frozen. And I didn't know it because I tried to keep moving, but we were crammed so tight, about 70 men in the car, you couldn't even sit down. I stood up and slept standing up in a corner. And there were a little trouble once in a while, guys would try to fight, but they couldn't fight because they were crammed close together. They couldn't even hardly draw their arm back, but it was getting pretty rough. And we kept beating on the sides of the doors. All we had was a little window at the top of each end of the boxcar, and that was it. And no toilet facilities whatsoever. And I always remember one kid got so thirsty, he tried to lick the frost off the hinge of the boxcar. Of course, his tongue stuck to the hinge. And before we got out of there, his tongue swelled up and he choked to death. And I always remember the sounds of that guy, I guess you'd say, dying, choking to death. But we got out of there, it was about 2,200 hours, and I was forced back into the car, and we carried 12 dead off of my car. And the guys that died, we just stack them up, because a lot of the guys were still wounded. There's 12 dead on my car. And I remember crawling out of that place, and some of the guys couldn't walk, so we just drug them through the snow. I'm still able to walk. And there was a edge of the woods, a big bonfire, and there's a lot of Kiwis, Aussies, Canadians, you name it, and British, and they had a fire and a big pot on there of hot tea. And we stood around that big fire trying to get warm. Some of the guys just still laying on the ground. And we got a cup of hot tea and a small sandwich. That's the first food I'd had for the last 6 days. Well, I had a couple of pieces of bread in my pocket before I left the prison camp. Beautiful night, stars, moon out. And I didn't have any idea what day it was. And then pretty soon I heard a big fat German guard behind me started singing Selig Nacht, which is Silent Night. Christmas was Christmas night. So I'd been in that boxcar for 6 days and six nights. And I was standing there, you know, kind of touching myself. I was still alive. And I felt somebody touch my shoulder. I swear it did. I turned around. There was nothing there. But it just gave me the inspiration. I said, Dukes, you're going to survive this. I still had 5 months, but I didn't know that. But you're going to survive this. But it gave me the inspiration. Well, then the fire died down. They run out of real weak tea. We were marched over to a building. By that time, it was probably 2,400 hours. We stood out in that cold all night long. Wouldn't even let us in the door. Finally, a little before daylight, they opened up, walked nothing but a big open building with straw on the floor. And we were issued one blanket. And so we kind of, at night, we slept huddled together, three guys, and always one in the middle to keep warm. You know, Lucky Pierre, always in the middle. And each man had a blanket, that was it. And just a bucket for a toilet and a pipe out the back door, back in. I was there about 5 or 6 days. I got one meal a day. And then I was finally loaded out of there and shipped to a Arbeitskommando, or a labor camp at a little village called Runddorf, which in German means round village. There had room for 40 men, and it had been a Russian camp, so it was a mess, and they moved the Russians out. Well, there's only 36 showed up. Some of us came from two different camps, I guess 4A and 4B, and I came out of 4B and into this work camp. Arbeitskommando 535, I found out later on. I didn't know that at the time. And a little barracks, and there was a room for 20 men on each side, and then had a wall, and in the center was a big table for our food. And I got one blanket, and I got in there with a straw mattress, nothing but a gunny sack full of wood shavings and a little bit of straw, I guess, and I don't know what else. And so I sacked out that night with my one blanket, and I woke up the next morning, and I was itching. I couldn't figure out what was wrong. Lice. The Russians had left their calling card. That thing was full of lice and fleas and bed bugs, you name it. And by this time, I had not had a shave or haircut since I'd been in combat, that they'd even been in front line. So I had a long beard and long hair, which is a beautiful place for lice. And so I was, you know, you start itching. Well, you soon learn to quit scratching, quit itching. You just They're in your clothing and everything else. You just have to learn to live with them. So that was our living, and we were forced to work every day. I had to walk as much as 5 to 12 kilometers into a place called Hoyerswerda, and we worked on the cleaning up the railroad that had been bombed, worked in the garbage dump, and we used to try to salvage string and newspaper. When sometimes in the morning we'd try to wrap our body with a couple of layers of newspaper and tie it with string to keep the air off. One of the jobs I had was digging a trench at a school that had been closed down and was used as a, actually as a hospital for the Germans. So it was all German soldiers and their wounded soldiers. And we were digging a trench to get a water line and a sewer line to part of that building. And all we had was a darn spike with a hammer to dig through the frost to get down to the thinking. Just stuff like this we had to do all the time. I did have 4 or 5 days working on a farm, threshing wheat. And that time I got a lunch that day. The Frau came out with a little red wagon and a big can of soup and some kuchen, which is white bread, because I lived off of, actually what I lived off of when I got home every day after walking to work and walking back to the woods. We had what we call a schissel, which was just a bowl, a steel bowl, and we get a bowl of soup and about 4 boiled potatoes with the jackets on and a big slice of German black bread, which I never liked black bread anymore, no white bread. And finally, after I'd been there maybe 30 or 45 days, the taste of the bread started changing. We couldn't figure what was wrong. So in one of our trips into the little village, once a week we'd go in and get our allotment of bread, and about 3 guys would go in with this wagon. We had to go pick up the wheat at a little farm and then take it into the bakery and exchange it for so many loaves of bread. So that's one trip we went, and we got checking out, and one of the guys went behind there while we were talking to the baker, and we found out they were dumping sawdust into the mixture. It either tasted like pine or oak. So by the time I got out of there, I was eating half sawdust and half in that bread. It didn't really got rough, but that was it. And we only got one, maybe one slice, and then everybody would get so much soup until the seconds were just what was left. Everybody, equal amount. Everybody was equal. We took care of ourselves. Well, this went on all spring, and a couple of jobs I had. I remember one of them spent a couple of days in the woods. We're cutting 9-meter logs and to build tank traps with. Well, they brought in some Hitler youth, so-and-so. They'd come in and they'd take off their shirts. And the way you could tell the SS, the regular SS would have 2 little lightning SSs on the inside of their arm. The Hitler youth would have just 1. Yeah, after you got to be maybe first class or whatever it was. And those little devils come in there, and this timber we were working in stripped down the waist, and they'd put one of those on one end of the saw and us on the other end. And they just saw till we'd practically pass out from exhaustion, you know. And then we'd load up those logs on our shoulders to carry them out of the woods to the wagon, and they'd be on one side and we'd be on the other, and we'd be walking out carrying these up, and they'd sing their German songs. Well, somewhere along that song, they'd all lift those logs over on us, you know, and we had to be prepared to, well, they'd crush us if we couldn't hang on to them, you know, and our neck was all scraped up. We had about 3 or 4 days of that. And then I worked on tank traps, building tank traps under bridges. And just manual labor. Carried on every day.
In general, how did the German soldiers treat you?
The German soldiers, the first ones, about the first 3 or 4 weeks, we had some younger guys that were wounded and couldn't fight, or at least were on maybe leave. And they were stinking. Then later on, we got old men from World War II, old pops and old bones, and we call them. And the only problem, they had German police dogs, and on a leash. And sometimes we'd be out and they'd get, I don't know, something to do. They'd let that dog come up and chew on your pant legs. See, I still got scars on the fronts of my legs where they got a little bit more through my pant leg, you know. And other than that, and then they carried black snake whips. I got whipped, I think, twice. One instance, we were digging a tank trap, which was illegal. And I was kind of leaning on my shovel against a big tree. And a real pretty little German girl, civilians were working with us, kind of come around the corner and handed me a little sandwich and cooking bread. And I looked at her, and I didn't have the heart, as hungry as I was, I didn't have the heart to take that sandwich. And I said, nine, nine, which means no. And she smiled, you know, boy, beautiful thing right there. And the next thing I knew, I was on my knees. And the guard had come up with that black snake whip and caught me right across the back to here, down here, and I, you know, went down immediately. But he just hit me once.
Would it have been worse if you'd taken the sandwich?
Probably would have. But I just looked that little girl in the eye, and she just, I don't know, I just wilted. I just didn't have the heart to take it. And then one other time, we were digging a tank trap or foxhole, and a rabbit come across there into this area, into his hole. So the other kid and I were digging this hole. We looked at each other. We moved, started digging the foxhole over where that rabbit was. And we dug him out. And we just tore him in half and stuff, guts and all inside of our jacket. But we only got a three or four briquettes of coal for our little stoves. And that never kept us warm, but we tried to cook that thing that night, but it was mostly raw meat. But those are the kind of jobs. But those guys were nice to us. I mean, you know, they never, the only thing, in one occasion we were working with, had SS come in, and they were stinkers. And I had a kid that, from the old Bloody Bucket Division, 28th Division, and he was a little shell-shocked. And we were working there, and he was kind of popping off to the guard, the German guard. So that officer come up, and when he was bent over, just booted him in the rear end into the trap we were digging. Well, I come over to help him out, and like a stoop, I made a couple of remarks about the Germans in English, which I should have known. He could speak better English than I could. I mean, the SS could. Well, the next thing I knew, I heard somebody yell, and I turned around, and he had grabbed the rifle off of one of the other guards and was coming at me, stuck the bayonet on it, and was coming at me with a bayonet. And there I stood. Well, I've had enough. I could pair what we call pair a bayonet when they come at you. Of course, they had the scabbard on then, and this one didn't. He come at me, and I backed away, and I knocked the bed away twice. And I figured, I've had it. Well, about this time, old Pops come running, hollering at the German and at me to rescue me, more or less, because we had two guards that day. And he had taken a rifle from the other one, old Bones, we called him. So I turned to look, and then the German straightened up and put a butt stroke in my jaw that about tore my head off, knocked out four teeth, broke them right off. I just had to spit them out, and almost unconscious. I laid in the snow there for a while before I could get myself up. I didn't have to work the next day though. I got the next day off, but I went around about the next 3 weeks with a rag in my mouth, clamped down to keep the air out of the roots of my teeth. And they finally healed over, and I never thought much about it, but my local dentist had to take the roots out after I come home. I was still in the Army, but a year later. And so I got through that, and they finally took some bone fragments out of the bottom of my mouth at the VA several years later. Other than that, one other time, we had a boy by the name of Debord, and he was a French Creole out of New Orleans, could speak French. Well, the French could sign what they call a parole. They put them out on a farm, and they could go 50 kilometers. They had a pass, so they could really roam a little bit. So they had a setup where they were finding an escaped prisoner. They'd run him through their underground to the American Allied lines. So we worked on his farm for about 3 or 4 days, and so he got next to some of these French prisoners, and they set up a deal for him to escape. So we worked out a deal one night, about, I don't know, 20, well, we, the lights were out at about 2,800 hours, 1,900 hours. So we set up a deal. He had enough of a French uniform. We would steal clothing every chance we would get. Well, the Germans, they were smart. About every 3 weeks, we'd have a shakedown about 0200 in the morning. They'd call us out, and we'd have our clothes and walk over to another building and hang our clothes on a peg. My peg was number 14, and I had to have my clothes on it. So some nights I couldn't sleep in my clothes, but most of the time that's what I lived in. Never did take them off, period. I never had them washed or anything. So we got a deal set up. We staged a little fight out in front of the barracks between two guys, which brought old Bones, who was patrolling the perimeter that night, come around with his dog to watch the fight. Well, when he did that, we opened up the back window, and he went out and climbed over the fence. And of course, it had the barbed wire, and got down the other side and got away. Well, they caught him, I think, 3 days later. But nobody knew it, so the next morning when we got out and have a count, you know, every morning everybody counts down, we were one man short. So they rant and rave and carried on, and old Bones, they called him out because he was in bed and told him what happened. He was going to get sentenced for letting a man escape. So boy, they turned him loose on us, and I was in the, we had two rows of a morning lined up, and I was in the back row, thank God. Well, he went down the front row and hitting guys with a rifle. A couple of guys got hit in the head, and, you know, got their head busted open. I was in the back row, and I got hit in my back here, below my shoulder blade, and I had three ribs cracked, I guess, because I couldn't take a deep breath for the next 3 weeks until they healed up. And it showed where they weren't exactly broken, but it hit me hard enough to make a pain back there, knock me down on my face. But that's the only time we really got any. In the little commander Fuhrer we had, we called him a commander Fuhrer. He was about this tall, short, pot-bellied, a World War I vet. And things would go bad, and maybe in my side, one of the guys wasn't working hard enough or something, so they'd call us out of a morning. He would walk up to me with it and grab that pistol out of his hand and stick it under my nose and push my head back and pull the hammer back on the thing, threaten to shoot my end of my nose off, just ranting and raving. And they start out in English, then they end up in German. So you had to learn enough German, you know, to know what the heck they wanted. So I learned the primary language was Nix Verstehe. That means I don't understand. We tried to get away with that. But that went on all spring, and then finally woke up one morning, and the little road in front of us was full of civilians in wagons and walking along there, and all the wagons were pulled by milk cows. There were no horses available anywhere. The army had all the horses. And it's pitiful to see these people heading away from the Russian front. Well, we watched that, and then we still worked a little bit, but not as much. But then finally, the Germans were kind of coming back from the front, and they would come by and see that was a prison camp. Well, they'd opened up with their automatics. So for about the last 4 days I was there, we stayed on the floor. Our barracks was all shattered from the Germans opening up. And so finally, late one night, they came to us, and there actually were 13 guards. But by this time, 7 of them had disappeared, and there's 6 left, and they were all on the other. See, the problem was I was on the Russian side of the Elbe River. So the 6 guards that were left were from the other side of the Elbe River. So they came to us and said, we'll make a deal with you guys. If you will give us your word that you will not have us shot, we'll get you to the American lines. We'll take you as a group, and we'll be armed and covered so that you're protected from the German soldiers that are roaming around the area. Well, what choice did you have? Because everybody's scared of the Russians. They were killing everything in sight. But this time, two of our guys were unable to walk from starvation. So you never leave a man behind. So we rigged up a little two-wheel cart with rope and loaded those two guys on. And at daylight, we headed west. Well, we had to go cross country because the roads were, you know, crammed. And during this time, I saw my first airplane, big new airplanes they had out. They were strafing everything. And they were jets, you know. And man, phew, I wasn't used to that. I'd never seen a jet. And so we had to be real careful going across country. Well, we didn't get very far. And we holed up in a town called Rosenthal in a schoolhouse. Woke up the next morning, a place was on fire. Russians had come in, raped the women, a lot of them, set a lot of houses on fire. They found us finally in this school building, took our six guards who were with us, took them out along the outhouse and lined them up and shot them, and then left because we were surrounded on three sides by Germans at this time. So we holed up, and we were there about six, seven days. We would hole up during the day in basements and then come out at night looking for food. Well, the German civilians weren't very nice to us in the first place, so we had a lot of problems there. And trying to get some food, I was there about 6-7 days, and we decided we've got to get out of here because the Russians were coming, and they had been there at one day. We never saw them again. And they were little Mongolians. You couldn't understand what the heck they said, and they little Shetland ponies. So we headed back west. Well, it took us 2 days to get back to Hoyerswerda. And I still only got one meal a day from the Russians. And then another kid and I finally took off, and I ended up in Saigon, Poland, by hitchhiking, and there was a big camp there. I thought maybe I could get out that way. Well, I couldn't. I spent a day there. So then I headed back west on my own. And one morning I was along a road in a garden digging up a rutabaga, the big thing that was for food. So I'm standing there working that by myself, and about three Russian tanks come barreling up through there, and the last tank come to a screeching halt, and the top opened up, and a great big buxom blonde woman pops out of there and motions for me to get on that tank. So I crawl up on that damn thing and get a hold of a couple of rings and hang on, and wow, we took off and we're headed west. We get into this edge of the woods, and the Germans opened up with what we called screaming Mimis, which was a multi-barrel mortar. But when it came in, it screamed like a banshee coming in. You could hear them coming. Well, one of them hit the tank. And I don't know whether the shell fragment or something. I got my head was split open from here about 5 inches. I'd have peeled me back. And blew me off the tank into the ditch. And I was about half conscious. I don't know how long I laid there. I know I was bleeding. But I finally came to, and there was two guys bending over me. And one of them was Jock McLeod, the 51st Highland Division, had been captured at Dunkirk. So he'd been a prisoner for four or five years. But he had a lot of medical. He was a medic, so he had a pretty good thing. So he and the other boy was Joe Plenderleith from the 15th to 17th King's Royal Hussars, which he was captured in North Africa. So he had been a prisoner for a long while too. And they were headed towards Odessa on the Black Sea, because we were over near Czechoslovakia. That was the only way to get out. But they worked on me and patched me up, and the three of us headed east. We get over there on, I don't know, edge of Poland or somewhere, and run into some British soldiers, and they said the war's over. We're going home. So we all turned around, and there were, I think, six or seven of us, and us three, and we headed west, getting trucks hopping trains or whatever we could get, headed west. I ended up finally, a couple other things happened, but that's kind of beside the point, in Berlin. And I woke up one morning, I was in some kind of a tube, I remember, on this flat car. I woke up with a bayonet in my gut, like from the Russians, you know. And the only way we could prove ourselves being American, dog tags didn't mean a darn thing to them. None of us had uniforms. So we put a red arm, piece of red cloth around our arm, and we would point to that, you know, and say, Marikonski, Marikonski, Dobra, which means good. And we kept the Russians off of us with that red armband. So I'm laying in this tube, and but a Russian, and I proved to him that I was an American, so they haul me out, and I'm in Berlin. So I go into this office, and this officer, and he said, well, we're going to repatriate you. So I was there, I don't know, maybe half a day, and they loaded me on a truck full of women and kids, and we were supposedly headed for American lines. Well, we head south out of Berlin, and we come to a place called Luchtenwald, which had been an Allied prison camp, Stalag 3A, behind barbed wire. I'm there for about 6-7 days, and every night, a lot of Americans, all kinds of guys, or DPs, displaced persons, would head out at night, headed for the American lines. Well, by daylight, here they came back. The Russians would pick them up, patrolling along there, and load them on a truck and bring them back. Maybe once in a while a guy would make it, get to the river. So another kid and I decided we're going to have to get out of here because I went to one edge of the camp real early evening, and they were loading up DPs, displaced persons, German soldiers into boxcars and heading for Siberia. Americans going too. Well, you know, we left about 20,000 Americans over there to the Russians. So we decided we're going to get out of it. I got knocked down by a Russian guard that evening too. He caught me, but I ran away from him. I don't know why he didn't shoot me in the back. He could have. So this kid and I, we stole a pair of wire cutters. We went to the very bottom two strands of barbed wire, and by this time, it was electrified, the wire, you know, normally was, but the Russians, heck, they didn't care. They weren't even manning the guard towers. They were having too much fun with the Russian, with the German women. So just at dark, we cut a hole through that fence, had two wire fences to go through. We crawled through that. We had to go across a minefield into the woods. Well, during the night, he and I got separated. And I was in a barn early the next morning trying to fill my pockets full of grain. And a farmer came out of the house, and I took off across the field. Got Russian patrol caught me, threw me into the truck, and I was back in prison again. So I stayed there that day and got my bowl of soup. Found that hole the next night, it's just a dark, and I went out by myself. Well, the night before, it was raining and everything else, so I lost my way. Tonight was a beautiful night, and I found that North Star from my Boy Scout training and said, I'm heading west. So I traveled at night for 3 nights, and then I'd hide during the day. And the morning of the fourth day, I found, come up over a big rise and looked down in the valley, crammed with people. And there was a Bailey Bridge, and I was at the edge of Wittenberg. And I get down in that crowd, and I'm the way I look, my beard, and I was an awful looking thing. Everybody got out of the way, and I just made my way through the crowd. I don't know, hundreds of people there trying to get across the river. And the bridge, the big iron bridge to the left, was all blown. And this was just a Bailey Bridge. And they were still exchanging man for man, Russian prisoners for Allied prisoners. They about quit that. This is the only place they were doing it, I found out later on. So I got to the front by the bridge, and there were three American Air Force officers there. And I remember they gave me some crackers, and that's the first food I'd had in about the last 3 days. And I just sort of wilted. I stayed there all night. The next morning, a big truck came up, a Timberwolf truck, incidentally. I saw that big Timberwolf sign. and they had some Russians on it, and they forced them to go across the Bailey Bridge, and then they would allow an ally to cross. So I crossed the river, I don't know, maybe 1,000 hours, 900 hours, got in that truck, and with some other Allied prisoners, and we went into Halle, and they examined me, and I remember the medic said, oh, how much did you weigh? How much you used to weigh when you went into combat? I said, oh, about 180. He said, you know what you weigh now? I said, no, 109 pounds. That's the last words I remember. I just passed out. And I woke up the next day. I was in Halle, in Reims, France, in a hospital. Laying in, I was stripped naked, but they had a kind of a canopy over me in his bed because the lice and the mess I was in, you know, I was filthy, dirty, my hands. I hadn't even washed my hands for days. But they had that canopy, I guess, and they were trying to get all the lice and things off of me. And I had two French nurses, and they shaved me with a regular razor, every hair on my body. I lay in that bed, and they shaved me, period, cut my hair. And then they put me in a big ornate bathtub full of nice warm water and scrubbed me, scrubbed my hands, because I was, you know, it's filthy. And I was there about 7 days, and there was a nurse by my bedside 24 hours a day. And then I finally got a uniform, and I went to Entretat, which was Camp Lucky Strike at Nihar, France. And by the time I got there, I got across the river 20 days after the war was over, 27th of May. So everything was closed down as far as the POW is concerned. I was one of the last documented to come out of Russian control, as far as they knew. So I get to camp, and they didn't have time for me. They had a setup where everybody went through a certain process, and they were interrogating me, and I finally got enough of it. He wouldn't listen to me. I said, you don't believe me. He says, no, we've monitored those camps. You guys had Red Cross boxes, you got this, you had your clothes. I said, I don't know what you're talking about, man. There was nothing like that in my camp. I never saw a Red Cross box. I got to write one letter a month, which my parents didn't get until the war was over. The first letter I wrote, they cut it up with a razor blade, cut out about half of what I said, and I got no mail. And for that 6 months I was in that camp, I had no idea what was going on in the world. We didn't know how the war was going on. We didn't know anything. There was no way for us to find out. So when I get to L'Entretat, he was giving me, I said, sir, you're calling me a liar. And I finally just stood up and saluted. I said, I'm leaving. I just made a about face and left. I figured I'd be court-martialed for it. But I was there another day, and I kept going to the head man, bitching like mad. Finally, after about the seventh day I was in camp, I went in the morning and said, got you taken care of, soldier. I said, well, wonderful. I got, $50 in cash and a pass to England. Delayed route, he called it. 7 day delay en route, then I would catch a plane and fly home. He said, I'm giving you a deal. You can have some fun. I said, okay. So I go to land in Bournemouth, South England, and go into London. And I didn't have too much money. It cost me 40 cents a night for a bed at the Red Cross Club. And the Red Cross didn't give you nothing. I mean, you had to pay for everything. Coffee or donuts, anything else, where the Salvation Army was free. And I roamed London, and I made some friends with some of my Canadian buddies. The 4th Division was over at Aldershot, so I spent a little time with them. And finally, I'd go down to Covert Gardens and dance. That was a big place where My Fair Lady was formed, as a big dance hall. The last night I was there, I passed out, which I was having problems with my stomach. And I had a head wound, and you know, I was losing it. Woke up, and the next morning I was in the hospital, and there's a nurse beside my bed, and I said, "Oh, what day is it?" She told me, "And what time is it?" I said, "Oh, I'm supposed to be at, I think, some Air Force, some air base at 0700 that morning." And then she said, "Well, you're AWOL, aren't you?" And She left the room. I got up, and my uniform was hanging over my bed, and I put my uniform on and went out the window. And I roamed London. I've seen everything there is to see. I mean, you know, like Madame Tussaud's waxwork and the Tower of London, and I've been out in the area, boondocks. I went up a central part of the country. But what I do, I get on a train, and I learned how to sneak by without paying. I'd watch the conductor when he'd come along collecting, I'd move, and then I'd come back. And so that's the way I lived. And then I finally got picked up, and I was court-martialed and charged 42 days AWOL, sent to the guardhouse in Lichfield, England, spent 8 days in the guardhouse.
And then when did you?
Well, then they called me out and said, we have reviewed your case. We considered you battle fatigue, and we were rescinding your sentence, but we're shipping you home immediately under guard.
Okay.
And they put a guard on me, and I went down to Bury, South Wales, and then I shipped out on a little old 7,000 tonner. Wow. Got home to Boston.
Wow. We're all out of tape now.
I'm sorry.
So we're all out of tape. So
I figured you were.
Now, you've been talking about when you had missed your flight out of England, and you were roaming around England, and you'd gone AWOL. Would you like to start back there?
All right. Well, I actually got picked up a couple times in stings, because you couldn't go to, if you went to Red Cross Club, you couldn't go to about 1 or 1:30 because they would run bed checks, the MPs would. So I've run out of money. I was at either Boston Club or the Columbia Club or two of the Red Cross Clubs that I kind of get a bed at night. So I learned another quick thing to make friends with the night clerk, the girl, and butter her up a little bit. So at night she would pick out a bed that was out of commission. And she would name the bed number, the floor number, and what room number. And so I would go about 1 o'clock or 1:30 and check either one of these two places, and they'd have a little card out there that said Timberwolf, and give these numbers so I'd know where to find a bed. So that worked for a while. Other times I slept out in St. James Park or Hyde Park or any place I could, or an abandoned building. And one little incident happened. I roamed around most of what they call the East End of London. That was kind of the poor section. And one day I was walking down the street, and I come to this one little tea room, you might say, where I've stopped a couple times for a cup of tea, just to kind of, you know, it didn't cost me that much. Sometimes it's a little gal would give it to me for nothing because I was in uniform. And being American, you know, the British should do anything for the Americans. So they were queued up in front of the door. People were. So I walked up and I asked this people, I said, what's going on? They said, well, the Queen Mother, Queen of England, is coming for tea at a certain time. Oh, fine. So they let me get in the line. I was about 10 or 12 from the door on this slant facing this way. And we stood around and talked. Pretty soon this team of horses with his carriage coming down the road, you know, ornate. And Queen Mother gets out of the carriage, walks up at the door, and she gets up across from me, and she stops and looks over, walks over to me, sticks her hand out, and she says, Yank, I want to welcome you to England. You have saved my country. I want to thank you very much. I'm standing there. What am I supposed to do? You know, I didn't know whether to get on my knees or bow or curtsy. All I could say, well, thank you, ma'am. Thank you very much. She turned around, walked into the into the tea room. But I was kind of interesting. Then I've watched the changing of the guard at the palace, and I, you know, kept busy. But it was rough. I ended up finally with a Beretta, 32 Beretta, that I carried in my left hand, and then I had a German blackjack that on a, was nothing but a spring covered with leather. And I carried that in my right hand. And when I walked the streets at night, you had to walk on the curb because there were so many guys like me that were living off the land that would mug you if they got a chance along. And then they would hide in the doorways. So, you know, it was kind of treacherous the way I had to live. But I was already an animal anyway, and my parents still had not heard from me. They got a telegram of missing in action, and as far as they knew, I was still dead, and I didn't have sense enough, or I guess I wasn't thinking. I never wrote home. They did hear something about me on BBC one time, an interview or something, but they didn't know anything. They were still waiting. And here I'm over there roaming around like a nut. And finally, you'd meet a girl. Well, you had to be careful because you couldn't touch them because they wanted to come to America. So I'd, go to dance or something like this. But then I'd get tired of this one. I'd say, I'm shipping out. And I'd give my address. And so when I got home, I had a big box of letters from about two or three different girls. And finally, my dad opened up one of them and wrote to this one girl. And he won't know what kind of condition I was in and all this kind of stuff. And she says, well, he's very thin, very nervous, and he feels like he had to live like an animal for so long that he wants to kind of get back into civilization again before he comes home. That was my thinking, I guess, of why I stayed in London rather than coming back to the States. And then, of course, after I'd inadvertently gone AWOL, let's enjoy a little more of England while I can. But like I say, the three-man tribunal that checked me out early one morning, on the 8th, I'd been there 7 days, at Lichfield, up in the Midlands. It was rough, too. I had to work. Well, the first 3 days, I worked the kitchen, washing pots and pans. And, of course, with what's called a replacement depot, REPL depot, I mean, they had guys coming and going all the time, being transferred in and out. So they were serving meals 24 hours a day, practically. Well, finally, after the third day, because of my wounds, I had been hit by white phosphorus on several occasions. That burns into your hands. And so I still had infections from that. I still had problems with them. So that old GI soap, my hands would swell up from the soap. So then they put me on garbage detail. So it wasn't that bad, but at least I was getting three meals a day, which I wasn't used to. But they finally called me in and said, because of your combat record, we've checked your record, we're going to rescind your sentence, and you're considered battle fatigued. And I noticed on the paper they had on the desk, I had the big red letters had psycho stamped on them. And that kind of got me. But I guess I was dangerous because they had a kid come in with a submachine gun, a young punk, and said, now this man is serving a six-month sentence. You have to get him to Barry, South Wales by 1800 hours tonight and turn him into a certain place, or you'll have to serve your sentence. Well, heck, I couldn't even talk to the kid. He wouldn't even talk to me. They put me in a chains. And down we went. So I took a train and we went to Barry, South Wales, and I got on little old James R. Turner. Well, things were still rough. It was all Air Force. And there were 13 of us guys who were all ex-POWs. I think about three of them were like me, had gone AWOL and gotten into trouble. The rest of them had married British girls. They'd been over there long enough to marry English girls. And so they spent their 60 days of POW leave with their wives or their girlfriends. And I still had my 90-day leave when I got home. So there wasn't any place for us to sleep. So the 13 of us kind of band together and slept on the deck. I slept up near a gun turret every night. And we sat around and we got a deck of cards. We played hearts. We sat around and played hearts all the time and became well acquainted. Well, we get just offshore of 11 days. Boy, I was watching for that grand old lady that I left from New York. I come in at Boston Harbor. So we get so many miles out and they put everybody below deck and said, sweep, what's the Navy term, sweep down fore and aft. We had to clean the deck. So they brought some brooms up and a couple of shovels. They called us 13 guys out and we're got to sweep down the deck. Well, but this time we were so bitter, we kind of looked at each other and I don't know whether I did or one of the other guys, a couple of the guys were sergeants, I was about the only private. We looked at each other and nodded, and the guys counted to three. We threw everything over the deck. I thought that he was a full chicken colonel, Air Force, was going to, oh, he just jumped up and down. You man, we'll be court-martialed as soon as we hit shore. So, but then we pushed back, and they brought up some other guys that got some other brooms, and they swept the thing down to get the approval. You know, we had to be checked out to get into the land. The ship had to be approved. So we get in there. Who's the first guys off the thing? We were the first ones off that ship. We're in the first in line. And went in, had Red Cross coffee and donuts. And I was slated to go to the hospital, Fort Miles Standish. And I was put to bed, but they had a guard at my door. I didn't know that because I just never got out of bed. And they were really feeding me real well because I still had a problem with stomach. Couldn't keep food down sometimes. And about the second day I was there, the guy came in, said, brought me in my uniform, says, get dressed, you got a 3-day pass. Fine. So I go out there, and there was a girl that I, Gracie knows about this, a girl that I had dated while I was in New York. She was lived up in New London, Connecticut. And I don't know how she found out I was there. She had been writing to me, but I couldn't write to anybody. Maybe her parents, or she called my parents. I guess she'd kept in contact with my parents. And, you know, when you're in the service, you always made as many friends as you could with girls because they were the ones that wrote to you. And mail was the most important thing in the Army, especially overseas. And we did have mail call about every day. And I got mail, but I never had a chance to write to anybody. But anyway, she had gotten me a 3-day pass. And we went up to her house, and she had three brothers, all three in the service. And I didn't stay at her house or anything like that. I had a little room at a little motel there, and her family paid for that. And all we did was just roam around and talk. But I remember the main thing I remember, I was dying for a butterscotch sundae. So I get one, but I had about four bites of it, all I could eat. I've never forgotten I had to throw away the rest of that butterscotch sundae. I was a waste. But I came back, and I was still in the hospital. And finally, I guess they were going to discharge me. I came back to Chicago, and then I took a train down to Danville, and I had 90 days of leave. And I just sort of roamed around, and I was having problems with my stomach, nerves. And I was supposed to go back to San Luis Obispo, where my combat division was stationed, and they were getting ready to go, of course, to Japan. Well, by this time, the war was over. And I think it was the 15th of September when I got home. So I was to report to Fort Sam Houston and sometime in November. Well, I was having typical problems, and got into trouble a couple times with liquor like most GIs did. And of course, I couldn't take it because my stomach wouldn't. About three or four drinks and I was done, you know. And it was, my metabolism was bad. I shouldn't even been doing it. I got into a fight once and got myself in trouble because I used my judo and I almost killed him with my bare hands. And he was in the hospital about 3 days and he survived, thank God, or I'd have been up the river. So my doctor, local doctor, said, you gotta quit your alcohol, and I did. But I get back to Fort Sam Houston, and I go through the hospital, they check me out, and I was having problems, prostate problems. And it was from the liquor and the poor water that they said that I had survived on such poor water overseas. And I'd been having trouble with pain, but I didn't know what it was. And they found out what it was, so then I was put in the hospital and I was given penicillin for a week, and that cleared that up. Well, then it came time for my discharge, and at that time, you had to have so many points to be discharged. And I've never had any use for the Air Force because I tried to join it and I couldn't get in because I was too tall back then. So the Air Force guys were pouring in, and they all had more points than I did. So I go through the line for about 3 or 4 days, and there was a good officer there. He was nice about it. I said, well, you got to come back tomorrow. Finally, I got enough of that. So that's one time I went through, I said, sir, I haven't been home for 3 years for Christmas. I said, last Christmas I spent in the God-blessed boxcar. I'm going to be home this Christmas one way or another. I'm either going to get discharged, furlough, or I'm going AWOL. So he's looking at my records, and the next day I came by, and he had my records. And he was looking at me, so he says, well, I see you've already pulled that AWOL trick. You're not going to try that again, are you? And I said, well, I'm going to get out of here. He said, well, just calm down. I got you set up. So he had already had it set up for me to go and give me my ruptured duck. And so I got discharged right there, thank God, and he's the one that helped me out. But I was in the hospital most the whole time I was there, and I was there almost a month. And then I got home I got out the 15th of December, and I got, I think, $75 for train fare. And I came up to St. Louis into Danville. And it's 15th of September. And then I went back to school, but I couldn't go back to school until January of 1946. And then another thing happened. I went back and I had signed up for 15 or 17 hours. I go through the line, and this girl standing there, said, I don't find you on the record. You sure you signed up? I said, well, yes, ma'am. You know, quite a while ago, of course, I made a couple trips down to IU and visit. She said, well, you go to the other desk over there. So I walk over there, and this girl gets my records out, and she kind of got red in the face. And I said, what's the problem, girl? She says, well, the Army says that you are psychologically unfit to take a full course. You can only take 9 hours. The first semester, I think for the first year, I only took 9 hours of classes. So it gave me a chance to, you know, in the fraternity. And so I was only there after 3 weeks. They had a special election, and I was elected president of the fraternity right off the bat. And, you know, I don't know why, because most of the guys there, a lot of them were GIs like me, but most all of them were either non-coms or officers. I was about the only private of the bunch. But so I was president up until the term ended. The guy that was president was called into the service. So that's why all of a sudden. And then I got involved with campus stuff. But I couldn't get attached to anybody. I mean, you know, if a girl got too close, I was gone until I met her. And we knew each other about 21 days when we decided to get married. That was it. So, you know, and I came home, but I just, you know, you're messed up and don't realize it. And that there was no way to help us. Now, of course, we got what they call PTSD, and I can get some support out of but I don't need it. Now she's my support. She's put up with me all through this thing. And then, of course, the book is what cleared everything up.
Has that been a big help for you, telling your story?
Yes. I didn't realize that. I was asked at the local school, and I spoke at just one class in high school, and then, I don't know, other teachers picked up on it. And I've been doing that for about 25 years now, and I've just got involved in certain schools, and when they come up to World War II, they just automatically call me in. But it's sort of slacked off. It began to bother me, and I know it, with my nerves, and I'm sorry to say the kids today aren't quite as interested as they used to be. Used to be, gosh, I mean, they'd, you know, hang around after class and ask questions, and I'd get letters. I got a box full of letters from the kids that in the schools that I've talked to. But their attitude has changed, and so I've just sort of backed off. I've been to some churches or something like that, but my idea was is to get the story out. And just a little sideline, the VA found a guy, he's been in a hospital for a while, but they just realized he was a POW. No record of anything, no medals, no nothing. So they got together and got all of his paperwork for DD-214, got all of his medals and his POW thing. And then he called me and asked me if I would do the honor of pinning a medal on him. So we had a ceremony yesterday at 2 o'clock at the VA, quite a few people there. And they had family from Texas and Chicago and all over. The whole family turned out because he's, well, pretty well gone and senile. So they come up and talk to him. They won't know if I could give him anything because he's never talked about it. The girls had never heard a word. So I said, well, she said, did you anything in writing anywhere we can get? I said, well, I wrote a book. And, oh, that's wonderful. Then I thought, well, I'll give the family a book. What the heck? So I went out and got a book, brought it in, and I was showing them stuff, and I signed it and everything. So then we're getting ready to leave, and boy, the family started coming to me. And the next thing I knew, I sold 7 books right there to the rest of the family. I felt kind of bad, but I didn't intend to do that. I was just, say, you read this, you'll get an idea now of what your father and grandfather has gone through. Because I just tell it the way it is, the way it happened to be. And he was infantry. I think he was captured in Italy. So he was there about probably a year. I had 7 months. But I, my idea was just to give him an idea. I never, didn't intend to sell books, but I was there till about a half hour.
Well, it's great that something that helped you get through it so well is something yes. that can help other people. Also.
And I've had people tell me how much it's helped them by reading it. In fact, the Indianapolis VA, the psychiatrist over there, he came over and bought 5 books, and they use it in their psychiatry. Evansville does. 2 or 3 VAs use it, and the kids to learn things from it and what you can do if you have to. It's that simple.
Would you like to say the title of the book?
Good Morning, But the Nightmares Never End. That was my theory, and I had terrible nightmares while I was writing it because I started in January, and I wrote all year. And we finally finished up about November. And I had a man over here that in Urbana, who's a school teacher, Ray Elliott. And he's the one that picked up on me. I spoke in his class one time, and he came over and said he would help me get it published. I wasn't even going to publish it. I was just going to type it up. Gracie was going to type it up and make copies for my kids. That's all I was interested in doing. And I'd send parts over to him, and he would scribble on sides of what I should do, expound on this and expand little things like the Ave Maria story where we went into combat, about 5 of us guys were roaming around on a Sunday morning and come up on a little village in France. And on the left-hand side was a kind of a dilapidated building, but there's people standing in front of it and people going in. And we come up with our rifles across our shoulder. And the guy came up to us and said, would you boys like to come in? We got a church service. Would you want to come in for a couple of minutes? So we walked in and they took us down the aisle. We sat in the front row, 5 of us, rifle between our knees, our helmet on the floor. And they have a sermon in French. Well, it was about overtime we got in there, I guess, kind of a dilapidated church. Well, as soon as it ended, on the left-hand side, it was kind of a little choir area, and about 20 to 25 French sailors come in, all in uniform, lined up. And the first song they sung was Ave Maria in French. Well, that just got me right there, you know, but just inspiration. I've had ever since, and in fact, I had it sung at our wedding, and Gracie had no idea in the world why I wanted Ave Maria at our wedding, but that was one of the things that kind of inspired us to keep going. And then another situation when we were in Aachen, we were going door to door, and sometimes 2 or 3 floors up in some of these buildings, because they were snipers shooting at us out of windows. So we were going up cleaning the place out. You'd go into a room In some cases, if you had a hand grenade, you'd throw that hand grenade in, and as soon as it exploded, you'd jump in with your rifle in case there was anybody in there and you hadn't gotten them. So I was going along with this other guy, and he was on one side of the aisle, and I was on the other, and we're creeping along there, and I heard a squeaky noise. So I dialed a hand grenade by then, so I didn't know what the heck to do. I fling open that door and jump in there, and over in the corner is a little old gray-haired lady in a rocking chair. But I didn't catch that. All I caught was the motion, and I wheeled around and shot. And I killed her. And she just sort of slipped out of the chair, and I lost it. Went to start crying, you know, my hands and knees. Well, about that time, down in the next room, something with an explosion of a hand grenade. And I caught out of my eye, I whirled around, and there was a picture about this size of Hitler. And that explosion had torn it loose, and it was sliding down the wall. And I whirled and shot. I got him right between the eyes. That tore me up, too. And I'm on my hands and my knees. One of my buddies came in, "What's wrong with you, Dukes?" And I told him what happened. Well, I just mentioned that, and Ray said, "Now, you have to expound on that, of why you did that." Well, I had to live with it, you know. Mm-hmm. And I remember I had that picture of Hitler rolled up in my belt when I was captured, and I was laying there on that pile of coal kind of coming to. A pain in my legs was finally waking me up. And my first sergeant laying there beside of me, a guy from Gulfport, Mississippi. He's still alive, too. In fact, he's got a birthday the next couple of days, Sergeant. And we were talking, and I said, "God, I need a medic, Sarge." And he says, "There's your medic right over there." There's a German with a Smizer, you know. And then I got to thinking, I got that picture of Hitler in here. If they find that on me with that bullet hole, and I've had it. So I took it out and buried it in the coal. I had a German pistol, too, that I buried in the coal. I'd taken off a German officer. But they were, you know, fairly decent to us. Those going back, it was kind of rough because if a guy would, several guys were wounded, and if they'd fall out, I swear to God that they were shooting our boys. I don't know. We'd hear a shot, and we figured they just, you know, didn't have time to take care of them anymore. And one of my buddies, a kid by the name of Bedell from Cincinnati, he had a piece of shrapnel rod in his neck, right near his spine, and he had to walk like this the whole time. And I did my best to help him. We'd help each other. But my legs finally, I had to walk. I finally just got over the pain. And it was not, none of it was deep enough, you know, to bar me from actually walking. But I had pain most of the time. But maybe that's inspiration you need to keep going. Yeah. We kept at it and helped each other. And it's the same way in prison camp. We didn't have that. You didn't have that stealing like you'd think, you know. Mm-hmm. I always kept a crust of bread left over and stick it under my pillow. And that would be my breakfast. And then we had a tin cup. They gave us a tin cup. We carried it on our belt for water. Because water is pretty important, you know. And the morning we got a cup of hot air, what we called ersatz coffee, made out of soybeans or something. And then that crust of bread, that was my breakfast. And my wife, for years, still left a crust of bread on my plate every night. And she'd always ask me and tell me, "There's, you left something." I said, "Yeah, I know, I'll eat it later." Just a habit that I got into. And I didn't realize I was doing it. And there's a lot of little things that she's had to sort of put up with that evolved while I was, you know, going through combat and prison that I was still doing. I remember one time, well, several times, when we first got married, I lived at the edge of town. I had about a half an acre. And at night, I'd just get jumpy as the devil. I'd load up my 12-gauge shotgun with number 4 buck. And I'd put maybe 10 or 11 o'clock at night, I'd patrol that perimeter of my house with that shotgun. when I first came home, I lived in the kind of edge of town. I go down the river, south of town, and I found a little alcove behind with a kind of a bluff behind me and a little stream in front of it. And I'd get between the stream and that as a backdrop, and I'd have my have a rifle and a pistol with me, and I'd build a little fire just at dusk. And I would sit there, oh, maybe 9, 10, 11 o'clock at night, huddled up at that little fire and listening to the sounds and getting it through my thick head that that's not an enemy out there. That's animals. They're friendly animals. I don't know how many times I did that before I got to the point where I could go out at night. Because, you know, we fought at night. And, you know, you sit there at night and you take the horizon and you'd pick out every object along that the horizon, because as it got dark, you had to watch it because the Germans would send patrols and stuff through, combat patrols. And you sat there and watched, and I swear to God, that stuff would move. Be a fence post there, and they could move at night. So you learn to look at one side of it. You don't look directly at it. You look to one side, and that's how you pick out your objects. But nights were just hell, because that we did a lot of our fighting at night. And I've had a few hand-to-hand battles that I survived. I got nicked a couple times with a bayonet, but I only got one Purple Heart. I could get two or three, I guess. I could get one for my jaw. But I didn't ask for it. I got my stuff in 1988 before I got my medals, and that's when we had a medal ceremony at Chouinard Air Force Base for all POWs. And we had about 4,500 people there, and we handed out POW medals. And it is ranked at the top of the service medals, incidentally.
It should be.
You know, you'd sort of wonder about that. They didn't issue those till what, 1988, and you had to get all kinds of proof. You know, I had proof because I was interrogated by the American Army when I came out. A lot of guys come out at big camps en masse, and they were just shipped home, you know, without any interrogation of any kind. But I, that's the way I could prove my Purple Heart. I had to show the guys my wounds, because nobody knew it. And now my combat badge, I always remember that. In my division, you had to have 30 days of continuous combat and have a recommendation from your old man or your company commander. Well, we were still fighting in the Siegfried line, and there were 7 of us. I think that's maybe all that was left in my company of the original men, or else some guys were back for trench foot or something. But anyway, I remember 7 of us standing there, and the old man gave us that badge, pinned it on us, and I remember, never will forget the words he said. He said, "Soldier, you'll surely go to heaven because you've spent your time in hell." I never will forget that. Wow. And that's just about how you can explain combat, you know. And there's a few of us that actually did the fighting when you get right down to it. That is, that lasted very long. Heck, some of our replacements come in and they last 1 or 2 days, get hit or, you know, wounded. And after a while, you get thinking, man, all my buddies, every time we have a battle, have casualties, but sure, we lose some replacements, but ever so often we lose one of our regular men. And you just almost lose it, you know, like, just drives you crazy.
You've definitely been through a lot.
Yeah, well, thank you.
You have quite the story. Are there any last things that you'd like to say before we finish here?
I better lay off of it. I never really thought that much about it till I started writing the book, and then it did all come back to me. Although I had, like I say, been speaking in schools, but I would lay off a lot of the intimate things that went on. Little instance that, and then you had to tailor, because to your group. I've spoken to kindergarten kids, letting in, you know, and so, and then I've talked to the senior citizens. Some of them sat there and talk while you're talking and so forth. So I've tried to adjust it that way. And then, of course, when I got the book, I got it all out, which I didn't get into the nitty-gritty stuff in. Well, just enough to get the point across is what I was trying to do. But I'm lucky. I mean, I think there's only, I think the last report, about six or seven of the original 36 that were in the prison camp, 32 of us left. Three of them got sick and went in the hospital, and then just one kid escaped. And as far as my company, we have a scribe, company scribe, and I get a letter about twice a year. And he lists all those that have died since, all those. He's got a list of all the casualties. Of the 70, that's how I found out there were 78 men casualties in my last battle. I had no idea because I'd lost complete track of them. And I think I've only been to one reunion or two reunions of my combat division. They have one every year. There was nobody there that I knew. Mm-hmm. One or two guys, and so I quit going to that. And I spent my time with the POW National and the local. I've been state commander and then work with that. And I'm a member of the Legion and the VFW and the Purple Heart and a member of all the organizations. Mm-hmm. And we have to stick together. But other than that, I don't push it that much.
Yeah. I'm glad there are all those support groups out there.
Well, hell, I was the only one in town. And when I came back, they looked at me kind of funny. And there are some guys that I guess are ashamed that they were captured. But you get in a situation where you're wounded. I was having trouble walking, but I learned to walk. You got a gun on your back, you'll walk. And I was out of ammo. One other little quick thing. The one guy that my buddy Lou Banduska tells me, he was a Kansas wheat farmer, he said, you were knocked down. A guy came up behind, even hit you in the head with a rifle butt and knocked you on your face. When I was kind of, I guess, sparring with somebody in front of me. I don't remember exactly. But I do remember talking to this one young German soldier. And we were staggering down a hill over the edge of this building. And he kind of called me to the side. I couldn't understand what was going on. And he said, in perfect English, he says, I'm an American. He says, I was born and raised in Oneonta, New York. I never will forget that. Now, I looked that up in a little village in upstate New York. And I think that helped save my neck. And then I think they were looking for Timberwolf uniforms. See, they had this Battle of the Bulge was planned. That happened just a month after less than a month after I was captured. They started that the 15th of December. And they infiltrated. And I've got some stories from my combat division history where they infiltrated my outfit and set up roadblocks and misdirected, you know, and... Mm-hmm.
So you think that they had been ordered to take as many prisoners of war as possible?
I think they were. They were smart. They knew what they were doing. Because I don't exactly how many did survive as POWs. I think that scribe may have it listed somewhere. But I did know that they did not retake the hill until the next day. There wasn't enough men to take it. And then K Company was on our left, and they come in and helped. Because the right flank was the coal pit, and I've since learned that was the largest man-made hole in the world with that big pit. So some of the guys were wounded, probably died on the battlefield before we could get to them. Mm-hmm. We were just so short-handed and that we couldn't get back up there, and it was, like I say, supposedly a very strategic hill, Hill 303, I remember that. And it had to be taken. Well, you know, that's, hell, we heard that story. You have to take that. Mm-hmm. And I've since learned that my division commander was the kind of guy that kept the Germans off guard all the time. Continue pushing, push, which I think one of the things that helped win the war. Today, what we do, I'm sorry, you've been over there, you like Vietnam, they'd take a village and then pull back. You don't do that. You take that ground and you hold it. That's, you got to kill the enemy and you got to capture the ground. That's if you're going to be in a war.
Absolutely.
And I think that's what saved a lot of us guys that were wounded. Most of our wounded got picked up by our own people. And medics, we've had medics go behind German lines and help our own medics. Back then, you know, we had one occasion where we found one of our boys with a bullet hole right below his Red Cross. A sniper had got him. So from then on, we never did take any snipers as prisoners. They automatically got, you know, the old man say, you got 5 minutes to get that man back to the CP, and I want you back here in 5 minutes.
Mm-hmm.
That's dirty to think about, but that's some of the things that happened.
Well, thank you very much for...
Any other questions?
none for me. Thank you for coming and sharing this with us today.
Well, I appreciate you giving me the opportunity. I just hope that what I've been through will help other people. And it has. I know. I've had people tell me that it has. And that pays me for, you know, anything that I've done. I don't brag about what happened. I just lucky to survive, but we made it. I think there were only 136,000 Americans taken captive, and we took 135,000 Germans just at Tobruk alone in North Africa. Mm-hmm. So the guys didn't give up, and about 90,000 of those were Air Force that were shot down and had no way to get out. Corregidor was 10,000. Battle of the Bulge was about 20,000. And the rest were just guys like me picked up. I think out of my whole company, there's only 40 or 50 ever taken. And most of those were like on a patrol, three-man patrol, get caught out. Or because we were on the offensive most of the time, where, you know, the Germans would get into a battle, and if they got... had to with retreat, they had to leave sometimes, leave their wounded on the battlefield. So that makes a difference too. And I noticed that there weren't that many Allied prisoners when you get right down to it.
Mm-hmm.
Because, you know, we were usually on the offensive. You have any questions?
I have nothing else. Thank you. Okay. Pretty well. I think we're finished then.
Good enough. I appreciate the opportunity.
That's very interesting.
It was like everybody says, a story should be told, you know, I guess.
Absolutely. Well, lots of things in there.
Ceiling, yeah, those are lights.
Yeah.
Thank you, Brent.
You're good.
Now I'll have to start going to... Someone else gave me the idea of going to a military cemetery just to see it.
Oh.
And
where?
Actually, that's the kind of thing that interests me, believe it or not.
Arlington?
No, probably something in Europe.
Oh, Margraten? That's where a lot of timber wolves are.
There wasn't a particular movie.
Was it last 2 years ago, the 60th anniversary of D-Day?
Mm-hmm.
And I think it was D-Day. And President Bush was over there. We have friends in Alkmaar, the Netherlands, where he first went into battle. They found this picture of us on the internet and knew he was a timber wolf and all, and sent a Christmas card and said, "We were your baptism of fire." About to pick him up off the war. And we've talked with him on the phone, and the two boys were 15 and 16 at the time. They had their own little museum. And
I think I may have seen their website.